Welcome back to our study on the second letter of Paul to the church at Corinth, 2 Corinthians. And yesterday I spoke about the three great exchanges that we get in the gospel story. The one exchange was when I die and I exchange my mortal body for something that's immortal. I use the analogy of taking off an old jacket and putting on something new, exchanging it for something new. That's called glorification. Yesterday, we dealt with the second exchange, which is sanctification. When a man or woman becomes a Christian, we are put off the old life of sin and selfishness and put on the new life in Christ. I've been crucified with Christ, and I'm now a new creation. The one word that we haven't dealt with, the one great exchange, is the thing that caused all of this to happen, to enable me to be sanctified and enables me to be glorified. It's what we call justification. And we see in today's passage the word reconciliation or reconcile, and it's mentioned five times. So let me read today's passage and then try and explain and make sense of it in the concept of a great exchange. So in 2 Corinthians 5, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. He's going to speak on reconciliation, what this great exchange, and then he's going to say that we now have the ministry of reconciliation, and he's going to finish thirdly with a call for people to be reconciled to God while they have time. But I want to speak mainly on the great exchange of justification today and this whole concept of our needing to be reconciled to God. A passage that's helpful in terms of reconciliation is Colossians 1, 13 to 23. When you talk about reconciliation, it implies two parties who need reconciliation, God and man. And so the passage in Colossians chapter 1 tells us certain things about our relationship with God. Verse 13, for he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. So basically, Scripture is very clear that man's position is not good if he doesn't know God. We were under the kingdom of darkness. We could not see the light. And when a person's in darkness, they are unable to see the light and unable to get their way out of the darkness. And in fact, they become used to the darkness. And that's the problem, that mankind has been blinded by sin and blinded by Satan and can't see God. And so it's a terrible position to be in, that we're in darkness and we'll spend eternity in darkness unless God rescues us from this kingdom of darkness. So that's man's condition as stated in Colossians chapter 1 from verse 13. But we get another statement made in Colossians. It's now in verse 21. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your mind because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. Once we were alienated from God because of our sin. And we've got to understand that sin drives a wedge between us and God. God is holy, sin is hateful to him, and therefore we can be in no relationship with God while sin exists. But he's reconciled us. We get these lovely words in Colossians chapter 1, but now, because of God's grace and love, God does something. And but now he reconciles us and brings us back into relationship with him. And he does that through Christ's death on the cross. The only way man could be reconciled to God was not by God sweeping sin under the carpet, but by paying for us. And so now I go back to the passage in 2 Corinthians and see what references we have that indicate this reconciliation that has taken place between man and God, and how God has enabled that to take place. So if I go back to the Corinthian passage, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we will see what he says. The references are that, verse 19, God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. So because of Christ's death for our sin, he paid the price for our sin. He who knew no sin became sin. Our sin was on his shoulders, the death. We should have died. He died in our place. He became a substitute. Sin was paid for. Sin was dealt with by Jesus on the cross. And the exchange that took place was that I put my old garment of sin on Christ. He paid for my sin, my penalty. He died in my place, and he gave me his righteousness. He gave me the exchange of his righteousness. So God looks down on me and sees me as righteous. And now I can be reconciled with God. It's a beautiful picture. Let me read a bit more from the Corinthians passage. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So there's a restatement of the position of the great exchange, that we have been reconciled to God. But this passage goes further than that, doesn't it? It says we now can be ambassadors for Christ to reconcile others to God. Has he really mentioned it? He said in verse 18, he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. And now here in verse 20, he says, we are Christ's ambassadors making an appeal through us. So because we have now been reconciled to God, we're his ambassadors to go and get others to be reconciled. That was Paul's ministry and this ministry of his team. And it's the ministry of every Christian, that we've got to get out there and encourage people to be reconciled to God. We've got to remind them of the dire position they're in. Colossians 1, you're in darkness. You're alienated from God. Other versions and passages and scriptures talk about being without hope and without God in this world. And I'm going to read now from Jesus' own words in Luke 12, verses 4 to 5. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that can do no more. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who after killing of the body has power to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? The greatest issue for humanity is to be reconciled to God. If he is not, then his soul is lost forever. And there's nothing more tragic in the life of man than to lose his own soul. And we need to understand those warnings. It was Michael Cassidy who said, I'm not able to speak much about hell, but all I know, it was serious enough that God would sacrifice his own son to prevent us going there. So the challenge is for us to go out and reconcile others and tell them, be reconciled. Your situation is in dire straits. It's very precarious. You need to come into relationship with the God who created you. What can be worse about being alienated from the very God who made you, to be in relationship to him? And the passage finishes then with a challenge to those who are listening, not only in Paul's time in Corinth, but to all of us. As God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, at the time of my favor, I heard you, and on the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. Friends, all I can say on this third point is that if you're listening and you're not a believer, I urge you with Paul and the whole church throughout the ages, be reconciled to God while you've got time. And the question will be is, where will you spend eternity? Did you ever get reconciled to God? Because you see, we're born without God and we die without God. And there's some time during our lives we make a clear commitment to Christ to honor him and serve him as our Lord and Savior. By faith, we believe he died for us, he paid for our sin, and broke the barrier between God and man and enabled us to be reconciled. Let's pray. Father, I pray for anyone who doesn't know you today to be reconciled to you while they have time. And for those of us who have already been reconciled, that we would continue as ambassadors of God, encouraging others to be reconciled. We ask this in his precious name. Amen. God bless you and see you tomorrow.